Can you turn me up in there? Okay. All right.
This morning, Church Brother C Band, ladies and gentlemen, they'll be here all week. Alrighty. What's buzzing back here? Oh, that's his thing. I got it. Now, what I'm doing is I'm waiting. Who got up early this morning? I know. No fair. But the good news is I'm not preaching, so you can't fall asleep. Yeah, baby. All right. It's good for you to be in the house of the Lord today. It's a great day to be outside. And Heavenly Father, we come before you loving you, praising you, and thanking you. You care for us. You love us. We are your baby children. You look after us. You feed us and you clothe us. You deal with a heart issue all the time. Oh, we're so grateful. We're so thankful. All the wonderful things that you do for us. You so love us. You're so tender. And you're gentle with us. And Heavenly Father, whatever these dear, beautiful people are struggling with today, Holy Spirit of God, move among them and touch them. The way the Master would when he taught. Touch them, Lord. Heal what needs to be healed. Convince and convict. We thank you and we praise you because you are a God who is personal and answers personal prayer. Praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, our scripture reading for this morning. Two passages from the Old Testament, Exodus 12:14, and the New Testament, 1 Corinthians 5:8. The Lord's Passover will be a memorial to you, and you shall celebrate it as a feast to the Lord. You shall also observe the feast of unleavened bread, for on this day I brought you out of the land of Egypt. Therefore, you shall observe this day throughout your generations as a permanent ordinance. 1 Corinthians 5:8. Christ, our Passover, also has been sacrificed. Therefore, let us celebrate the feast not with old leaven, but with the leaven, not with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Glory to God. Amen. That's His word. Sharon, y'all stand up. She's going to make you stand up. Stand up now and let's sing to God.
All right.
Give it up.
Good morning, everyone. Thank
what do you say, Kyle?
Glad you're here. Hope that you'll join in and sing with us. It's a great day to be here at church at the same. Glad you're here.
Everyone needs compassion.
Doing great. Keep standing with us.
Next one's one of my favorites on my Joy FM. I believe it's Chris Tomlin. This one? Yeah. Thrive.
Yeah, sing it with us, please.
We need all the help we can get.
That's right.
The voices.
You guys sound awesome this morning.
Yeah.
seated. Ladies and gentlemen, let's continue to worship the Lord as we receive the Lord's tithes and our offering. I usually say, give us all your money. Do better than that. Y'all stand up and greet one another this morning. Come on. Say howdy. How you doing? Howdy. How you Thank you. can see it. Y'all may be seated, yes, anytime now. Of course, y'all needed to stand up, you know, because I know the sermon is an hour and 57 minutes this morning. Ladies and gentlemen, this is my dear friend, Dr. Jeff Spanos, and Jeff will be bringing the word to us this morning. Jeff Spanos, ladies and gentlemen.
Good morning. Dr. Dave and I are talking about Easter and how many people come to your Easter program. I said, do you need a break to get prepared? He said, are you kidding? Yeah. So I'm here to give him a little spell to get some preparation done. I think 1,200 people come to your, let me pull this down a bit. Is that good? Okay, all right, try that. Love to be here with you. Thanks for letting me be here. Let's pray. Lord, we come to you today knowing we're in this Easter season, and it can be a real downer in the sense of remembering the sins of the world. But as we just sang, you lift me up. It's so that I can do great things. You've lifted us up. And I pray that in this sermon today that you would remind us of the things that are in our lives that maybe we regret, you can take and work in and make great things. So Lord, we ask that you would help us open your word, help us to see what you want for us individually as a church, and Lord, that you would be honored and glorified in all that's said and done. Pray these things, Jesus, in your name. Amen. Have you ever done anything you've regretted? Yeah? You don't have to raise your hand. Maybe both hands. Something that you've said that you certainly wanted to take back. You know, you can't take back words. What about something that you've done that has altered the course of your life that you regret? Or maybe even worse, they altered someone else's life. And I know that there are things in my life that I regret and that I want to take back. There's a man that you may be able to understand. His name was Charles Colson. Remember Charles Colson at all? Chuck Colson was the right-hand man to President Nixon. He was the guy who instigated all the trickery in the White House. He was known as Nixon's hatchet man. In fact, he had an internal memo that was leaked that said, I would walk over my grandmother for Richard Nixon. Can you imagine that? Nixon said he didn't have a moral compass for the first 41 years of his life. It was about Chuck Colson. And Nixon, in the White House, he was his presidential aide. He was at the top of his game politically. He had won. And yet, he was the instigator and the mastermind behind Watergate. He was indicted. He went to jail. Looks like everything in Chuck Colson's life had stopped. He was going to be passed over for anything that was good politically, professionally. This guy was a liar, a cheat, an instigator of wrong, and he got caught. There's a guy similar to this in the Bible, in Chuck Colson's position. His name's Moses. Remember Moses? Moses was saved out of the water from all the babies that were being killed. Pharaoh was jealous that the Israelites had all this, the money, the best land. He had forgotten Joseph 400 years before that. Had saved the whole country, and Egypt had become the most powerful nation in the world. And Moses is saved through pushing him out into a basket. His mother had tried to have faith in the Lord that we're not going to kill this baby. He's saved out of the bulrushes. Who finds him? Well, it was kind of put together. The mom pushed it out. The sister pushed him out to the Pharaoh's daughter. The Pharaoh's daughter picks him up. Loves, all of a sudden loves him, that's God's heart, and raises him as her own. In the Pharaoh's house, most powerful nation in the world at this point. So Moses is slated to be part of running the country as a Jew. But one day he sees two Jews fighting, and then he also sees some Israelites fighting. I mean, some Egyptians fighting with the Jews. And he kills the Egyptian and buries him. People saw him. He got caught. He fled. Where did he flee? Do you remember? Some place called Midian. 40-something years. And what did he do? He tended sheep. From the White House, like Colson, to the jailhouse, from the Pharaoh's house, the top in the world, to the sheep's pen or sheep's house. Can you imagine? This guy says, I'll never have a career again. I'll have nothing important to do. There's no way that after killing a man, going from the top echelon in the world to sheep's house. Anybody ever been around sheep? They stink. They bite. They're dumb. It's not their fault. But it's not, they need a shepherd. So anyway, Moses does this for 40 years. You see, I'm here today to tell you that God is a God of second, third, and fourth chances, isn't he? Because we know the story doesn't end there. As Moses is tending sheep and he's doing all these things, he's getting married, he does get married, have some kids, he recognizes that God is stirring something in him. And remember that burning bush happens out there? God talks to him in the bush. He says, hey, you're going to be my leader. I'm doing something great here. And what he finds is that God has a heart for the Hebrew people still. Remember the promise to Abraham way long time ago? He had promised Abraham that the Hebrew people would be in their own land, a land that was flowing with milk and honey, that would be just a place that they'd have their own. And where were they? They were in the most powerful place, the most fertile land in Egypt, but it wasn't their home. And Pharaoh was making it harder and harder. Remember, he even took the straw away from making bricks. And then he says, you're going to kill your babies. They're 2 years old and younger. And God says, no, I got a bigger plan. And God is a redemptive, forgiving, plan accomplishing God, isn't he? He doesn't leave us where we're at. He doesn't leave us in that. And we sang about it. He doesn't leave us in our sin. He picks us up. He lifts us up if we repent and we come to that. And so this story of Moses leads into God's salvation of his people physically in the Passover. So we're in the Easter period right now, right? We're in the second week of Lent. And coupled in that is really the Passover. And Jesus was to die on the Passover, just like the lamb. And we're going to find the lamb that Moses has to kill is this Passover lamb that saves the people. So the people are told, take a lamb, 1-year-old male without blemish. I want you to kill that lamb. This is in Exodus 12. Take a branch of hyssop, dip that the blood with the hyssop on the lintel of your door. You remember where you're supposed to put the blood? On the doorpost, the top and on the sides. And when the death angel comes and sees that, he will not kill your firstborn. Because what was going on? There was a battle going on in the middle of Egypt, the most powerful nation in the world, and God. And remember the plagues? The 10 plagues were the 10 gods of Egypt that were the power of Egypt. These were demons. So this was a power encounter. This was God against the demons of the world for his people, Israel. So every plague he knocked down. Like if you had a god shelf, if you've ever been in someone's house that has, like, is Buddhist or Hindu, they've got a bunch of little gods. And I used to be in people's homes. I'm like, what happens if I knock this one over? I don't know. Don't do it. I'm like, well. So God was knocking down each of the gods on Egypt's god shelf and saying, what are you going to do about it? I am the God of the universe. I am the only God. These are demons in disguise. And so as he does that, he knocks the gods off the god shelf. The last god that remained in Egypt that he did do business with was Pharaoh himself. You remember Pharaoh, like the Roman emperor was a god. Pharaoh was a god. He was worshipped. And who would be second in line to that god is his son. So God was going to do business with the firstborn of all Egypt. This is the last plague, the last dealing with the gods. So God says, I'm going to knock off that last one. In verse 12, in chapter 12, he said, Verse 23, when the Lord goes through the land to strike down the Egyptians, he will see the blood on the top and the sides of the door frame and will pass over that doorway, and he will not permit the destroyer to enter your houses and strike you down. Obey these instructions, he says. This is a lasting ordinance. You're going to remember this. Every year I want you to retell this story to your children. At verse 29, he says, at midnight the Lord struck down all the firstborn of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh who sat on the throne, to the firstborn of the prisoner who was in the dungeon, to the firstborn of all the livestock as well. Pharaoh and all his officials and all of the Egyptians got up during the night, and there was a loud wailing in Egypt, for there was not a house without someone dead. God did significant business here. Because he had said back in Exodus 3, I hear the pleas of my people. I recognize that you're crying out. You have a hard taskmaster. And I'm going to take my people out of this land to their own land, a place of milk, flowing with milk and honey. And that's where we get that in chapter 3 of Exodus. And it was important that this lamb that was going to be killed had similar, this is a foreshadowing of Jesus. And he had to be male, had to be firstborn, had to be without blemish. And then we see that the bones won't be broken as well. So it was a perfect picture of what's going on. So God always has a bigger picture. As believers, we should never worry about the future, because we already know our future is what? It's secure, isn't it? I mean, we already know we've bought heaven, let's say, but most of us live for heaven and we don't live enough on the earth, because we're living in a regret. We're living in the power of the world rather than the power of God. And God wants to come in and says, listen, don't live in that regret. Live in the victory that I've paid for. See, a lot of us keep working, try to please God. And why is that? Because we don't think that Jesus' death on the cross was enough to pay for our sins? Sometimes I live that way. Sometimes, do you live that way? Like, if I just do this better thing, or God, sorry, you know, I'll do better. We need to recognize that our sins have been paid for fully on the cross. So here's what I say to people. What, you know, if you don't know if God loves you, you're going to work. But if you know God loves you, he's already forgiven you, you're going to work in a different way. You're going to, one's you're going to work because the scale I don't know is balanced. The other one is, I'm going to work because I know God loves me, and now I work out of gratitude. You guys have, anybody have children that one of them works because he doesn't know if you're going to spank him? Or the other one, another one works because he just loves being your kid? He's like, Dad will love this. Mom will love this. And that's the way that you and I live, don't we? We wonder if our Heavenly Father really is just going to spank us because we did something wrong. Or can you live a life, can you get to the place where you say, Lord, no matter what I do, I know I'm always a son. I'm always a daughter. Isn't that awesome? I'm always a son. I never lose that perspective. I never lose my sonship. I never lose my being a daughter of God. So I'm going to live my life in a way out of gratitude. It takes a while to get there. And it has to be bathed in prayer. It has to be short accounts. It's just like your relationship with your spouse or your best friend. It's the short accounts. It's not letting things go long. And see, God cares so much. See, this Passover that was happening was not a Passover to forget the Israelites. It was a Passover to new beginnings. Chapter 12, verse 1 says, this is the new year. This starts the new year for the Jews. So before, they didn't have a year. Their calendar was based on everybody else's calendar. Now God says, this is the beginning of the year. And this is the time you're going to start. This is brand new. I'm passing over not to kill you, in order for you to have a new beginning. Isn't that awesome? You know what year the Jews are in right now? 5,776 since the Passover. And they celebrate that. Though they don't know about Christ, for some reason, Laura and I, my wife is here, we lived in Jewish households while we were in grad school, when I was in seminary. And we'd sit at the Seder table and Passover meal, and like, do you know what that means? Wow, our mouths would open, because as Protestants, we really didn't go through that ritual, but the Jews still do today. And they don't know what it means. They know the Hebrew part of it, but they don't see the other things that go on, where the lamb bone and where it just symbolizes so much Jesus. I said, what about this lamb? How are your sins paid for now? I'd ask my Jewish friends. They're like, we don't know. What do you mean? Well, how do you get your sins paid for? We kind of hope God loves us by what we do. I'm like, I got some good news for you. God already loves you through Christ. Christ came to, remember that Passover lamb who the blood saved the people? Now, the death on the cross of Jesus, that blood, like the Passover lamb, he becomes the Passover lamb. And the New Testament tells us that in several places, that he is now the Passover lamb who takes away the sins of the world. Isn't that awesome? That's good news. And my Jewish friends still couldn't get it, because you know it's a Holy Spirit thing. You know, my Protestant friends can't get it either, my Gentile friends. Hey, if God is working in your heart, and that's why you keep loving people. You don't know what God is doing. In their regret, people live so much, I've had family members live so much in their regret that they can't even think God would love them at all. I said, that's the point. While you're in your trespasses and sin, Jesus died for you. That's the good news. Isn't it awesome? Easter. In fact, God says this through Paul in Romans 3:9. He says, for we have already made the charge that Jews and Gentiles all alike, they're all under the power of sin. As it is written, there is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. So Paul says, hey, that was a poem that he was writing from the poets of his day. You can look at it in Romans 3:9. But see, God hears, and he cares about us. Paul doesn't leave us there. In just a couple chapters later, in Romans 5:6, he says this. You see, just at the right time, when we were all still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Just like the Jews who were powerless in the nation with the Pharaoh, they were at their wits' end. They were slaves. Their babies were being killed. They were at the very end of knowing what to do. And God came in and saved them. Sometimes in our own lives, we feel like I'm at my wits' end. I don't understand what's going to go on next. Well, the good news continues in verse 8 of that same chapter. 8 and 9 says, but God demonstrates his own love that while we were sinners, while we're still sinners, what's he do? He dies for us, right? This is not a new story, but maybe it's a new story to some of you. And maybe it's not a new story to you, but you need to hear it today. Do you need to hear that today? I do. Every day, there's some guilt, there's some regret that pulls up into my mind, and as much as I try to push it back down, I live in that sometimes. I live in fear of things. Even coming up here, I was in ministry for 25 years, and I haven't preached for several years, and I'm like, my wife's, you're okay? I'm like, the Holy Spirit has to work in this. Just like when Dr. Dave comes up here every week, he says, if the Holy Spirit doesn't show up, I don't know what's going to happen. Yeah, we need to prepare. Same with you. When you go into your colleagues or you go in with your friends, you're talking to your friends, it's your character that's going to make a difference in their lives. What they see in you is not a perfect. They don't want to see a perfect person. They think you're perfect already because you're already telling them you are, right? They want to see your brokenness. They want to see your hardship, your regret, turned around and saying, wait a minute, you know, that's all a part of my life. But God works in that to make something amazing and beautiful. He wants to bring victory into our lives, victory in a way that you know it's not you. There's no way that you know it's you. And see, God humbled Moses to that point. Do you think he learned anything tending sheep for 40 years? Yeah, sheep bite, right? Do you think people bite? Yeah, he was being prepared to lead 40 more years of people. I think I would have stayed with sheep, right? You know people. How come no one's laughing? It's true. People are the hardest people to live with and the kind of entities to live with. But God has made us to become more like him so those relationships become beautiful things. So Paul says he demonstrates to us his love while we were still sinners. And Jesus had to be similar to the lamb that was slain for the Passover. As the Passover lamb, he was male. He was out without blemish, without sin. His blood was put on the cross instead of on the doorpost. The blood came from the cross, and he was the perfect lamb. So the key here is that God has a bigger picture in all of this. I have a friend that struggled with some regret. He's a colleague of mine until a few months ago. As a financial advisor, he had come in and got all his licenses. He had got his Series 7, also went and got his planning status, so financial planning status. That's not for somebody that's just can't pass high school. I mean, this guy had all the certifications, all the degrees, went for other certifications, and he was helping people financially, helping them with their retirement, helping with life insurance. But the problem was he couldn't make a living at it. He was like, and as a believer, he's like, Lord, really? I'm trained. I'm not that I'm smart enough, but you've allowed me to pass all these exams, which are hard. Some of them are all-day exams. I'm helping people. It's almost like ministry because I'm helping people with their money and the resources, talking about their kids, who's going to be the beneficiaries. He did a lot of free work. Problem was he was going through his savings. He went into debt. 4 years doing this, he's like, Lord, this is embarrassing. This is not anything I want about my life. I'm regretting that I even took this path. So in prayer, he kept praying out. And then he asked his friends, he asked me, can you pray with me? What am I supposed to do? And we just kept praying. And the Lord seemed to drag his feet. But what he was doing with John was taking him deeper into the Word. He was taking him deeper into a relationship with him. He had to cry out to the Lord. And what happened was a friend of his came and said, hey, I don't know where you are in your career, but my company's growing. I really need someone like a financial officer in my corporation. I have no idea about the benefits and this and this. And they sat down for about four hours and talked together. And it was perfect timing. They both cried at the end of the meeting, saying, I cannot believe this kind of timing happened. And as both of them as believers said, this was perfect timing for you to come on and help my company. And John revealed, I'm not making it. I know I have these great skills, but I can't get enough clients for some reason. It's a hard place for competition. So it's a perfect thing. So the last 4 months, the company has brought in benefits. It's not doubled as business, about 40% business more in 4 months. And John is on some financial path that's very helpful. So that's the kind of God we serve. But sometimes it takes a humility that God has to take us to. He has to bring us to a place of saying, God, I need you. I need you. Men particularly, I've got two master's degrees and a doctorate. And I'm like, I could say, when I went to Vermont, I church planted. It's one of the hardest places in the world, they say, in America. Vermont is just unchurched beyond imagination. And they tell us that. They said, Jeff, we don't need God. Look at, we cut our own wood, grow our own crops. If we can get through this winter, we don't need God. And I'm like, wait a minute, where'd you think that all came from? So we had some good conversations. But when we're there, I was like, God, do you really going to sacrifice all of what I've done, all my wife has a master's, all these things, and you're, what about the people? And God just had to humble us to a place of prayer before people even started to, because it's not about you or me. It's about the power of God. And as you pray about your friend, your family, most of my family members have come to Christ, not because I was a good person, but because I kept telling the truth and my character was changing. I had people I went to high school with, I'm from Sarasota, Florida, and they went to high school with, they said, Jeff, you're a different person than when you were in high school. Yeah, I was a football player, and but God got a hold of me early in those years. But that's the thing, God has to come in and see you where you're at. You need to humble yourself before him. He's not going to change and give you great things without some humility. I wish it was different, don't you? Lord, I just said, hey, I prayed that prayer, Lord, tomorrow, right? It's years. And those who are the oldest here probably know that it took Moses 40 years to get it and get humbled. Chuck Colson, you remember him at the beginning of the sermon? Chuck became a believer right before he went into prison. And it wasn't, he didn't even know he was going to be indicted. What happened was he had a drinking buddy who was did a lot of stuff with him, and this guy had come to Christ a couple years before. And as he met with Charles Colson, Chuck's like, something's different about you, man. What is it? He says, I became a Christian. And it was like a foreign language to Chuck Colson. He was like, what are you talking about? Intelligent people do not believe Jesus, you know, or the Easter Bunny, you know. And he just kept loving on him, telling the story. And eventually, Chuck Colson became a Christian. He gave him the book Mere Christianity by C.S. Lewis. And this is even before Chuck knew he was going to be indicted and go to prison. Chuck went to prison. He was there for 11 months. And while he was there, he's looking around. He's like, Lord, what am I supposed to do? I've been passed over. My political career is done. And God said, look around you. These are the men that you're going to be working with. He's like, no, I don't want to be in prison. No, he says, when do you get out of prison? He's like, what? He said, look at these prisoners. They already know they're broken. They need help. They need hope. And even if they get out of prison, they need help, and they need hope continually. They know they're broken. So what Charles Colson started was Prison Fellowship. You ever heard of it? Prison Fellowship went back into prisons worldwide. Some of the famous ones were into the Gulag, into places in Russia. But most every prison in the United States, Prison Fellowship has had some ministry of teaching Bible study, leading men to Christ. And then he started a Worldview Academy that actually helped people defend their faith. So even that brokenness, that seemed like, I'm done. I have no way of doing anything that's important. God doesn't pass over that opportunity. He takes us and he makes us say, please, God, help me to love you and want you more than whatever I want. So this Easter, don't pass over Jesus. He's a redemptive God. He loves you more than you can imagine. And in your pride, or your brokenness, the hard things of life, humble yourself before a living God who loves you. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you. You want to live a life victorious? It comes through saying yes to God. Would you do that with me this Easter? Yeah. Let's pray. Lord, help me to live a life of victory in Jesus. I ask you to forgive my sin. Please come in and make my life new. Help me to give you my regrets. Give them all over to you. All the things that weigh me down right now. The things that are coming into my mind that I've been hanging on to. The things that are hanging on to me. I give these regrets and these sins over to you to forgive. Take them away. Help me from this day forward to choose to walk in joy and victory because of what you've done for me. Oh, Lord, thank you for loving me. I know the battle belongs to you. Help me to walk in you. Help me to believe that I can give this over to you and you will win the battle in me and through me. Jesus, in your name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Sing again. Okay, good. All right. Yeah, we're going to sing again. So the band get on up there. And when y'all think about it, stand up. Might take a little bit, but wobble up. Oh, you're... I know. Here I go. Sure.
All right, the last song we're going to do is called Forever Rain, and not the wet rain, Rain Victorious. I love St. Petersburg because there's always sunshine.
Thank you all for worshiping with us this morning. We hope that you'll be back and worship with us again real soon. Sing with us.
Thank you.
Well, I hope y'all have a wonderful afternoon today. It looks like the sunshine's coming out. It's going to be a beautiful day. Y'all listen now. She said basketball, and that now that's, I was going to do the benediction. She said basketball, and I go, well, who won, Duke or was it Notre Dame? Who won? Duke? Okay, good. So the Methodists beat the Catholics last night. All right. Whatever. Jesus Christ on the cross paid for our sin debt in full. We owe nothing. Therefore, God has passed over our sins and has given us eternal life in Christ Jesus. Now, go in this reality. Live this message out this week. The Lord loves you. Go in peace. See you next week.